Let's go ahead and graph some polynomials here. So in order to first start with graphing these, we need to keep in mind that there's two different formats that they can be in. So polynomials can come to you in standard form, like for example, y equals x squared minus 1, or they can come to you in factored form. The same polynomial, when factored, would be a difference of squares, x minus 1 times x plus 1. Hopefully it's pretty clear between the two which one's factored and which one is not factored, but you can always tell based on whether you have a product or you have sum and differences of terms. So for some things, the standard form is going to be more useful, and for some things, the factored form is going to be more useful. Okay, so before we jump into graphing these, let's go ahead and define some vocabulary that we're going to need. We're going to need the left end behavior. So as x goes to negative infinity, where do the y values go? And the right end behavior, which is as x goes to positive infinity, where do the y values go? So let's go ahead and look on a picture and identify our left and right end behavior. I've drawn a couple functions here for us. We don't need to worry about the formula because we're just going to look at the picture. So looking at our example A, we have a function. Let's look at the left end behavior. Okay. So looking on the left here, as x goes to negative infinity, that means as we look at this tail end, where is it headed? It looks like it's going down, and it looks like it's going down without bound. So that would be end behavior of negative infinity. So if we want to be fancy and formal, how we would write that is we'd say as x goes to negative infinity, y goes to also negative infinity. Okay, the negative infinity is what we saw when we looked at this tail end here. Okay, now let's take a look at the right. You guys have any ideas? Okay, it looks like as we look to the right, as x goes to positive infinity, looking at the right, looks like it's climbing up without bounds. So again, positive infinity. Perfect. And with this notation, we're getting you ready for calculus, where we're going to use these arrows, and the arrow simply means going towards. So getting us ready for calculus. Let's take a look at example B here, and let's see if we can do the end behavior for this one. So I chose this example, which would not be a polynomial, side note. I just wanted to illustrate that your end behavior does not, in general, always have to be positive or negative infinity. It can definitely be finite values, which is going to come up when we're working on graphing some other functions in a future chapter. So when we're looking at this function, as x goes to negative infinity, so to the left here, looking at the tail, where is it headed? Well, we see this asymptote that's drawn at y equals 0, and it looks like this is going towards y equals 0, hence why the asymptote is drawn there. So I believe that is our end behavior. As x goes to negative infinity, y goes to 0. Okay, and I don't believe I actually know that. I'm just, you know, sometimes I phrase myself a little bit interesting here. Let's take a look at the right end behavior. As we look to the right, looks like, again, this function is trying to lay down on its asymptote. So as x goes to positive infinity, y goes to 0. Okay, so that's our end behavior. Okay, now let's jump into how we're actually going to graph these polynomials. Okay, so what are we going to need to start with? The first thing we're going to need is we're going to need the leading term. Okay, so the leading term, as you would imagine from the name, it is the first term. It's the unfactored form. You look at the unfactored form of the polynomial and you look for the term with the highest power. And why we care about it is because it gives us the end behavior. So if we take a look at our example that we've been working on here, I see two terms in this polynomial. There's the x squared term, there's the negative one term, and which one of those has the highest power on x is the x squared. So the leading term would be x squared. Okay. Pretty simple to spot the leading term in unfactored form, so standard form. The next thing we're going to need in order to graph these is we're going to need the factorization. So factoring the polynomials is important because it will give us the zeros and the behavior at those zeros. We're going to be paying attention to when it factors, how many times does a zero show up, i.e. what is its multiplicity? And here's our little pattern for how these functions are going to be graphed considering what the multiplicity is at those factors. So for the future reference, zeros with multiplicity even will bounce at that zero, zeros with a multiplicity one will be crossing, and zeros with multiplicity odd but not one will wiggle. So let's take a look at our example and identify our zeros and whether the multiplicity is even, one, or odd. Okay, so it looks like our zeros here, remember they come from setting each factor equal to zero. So the zeros are 1 and negative 1. And then we look back at the factorization and we look at the number of times that they've been repeated. How many times is that factor present? So looking back at the x minus 1 factor, let's color code it. Here's the x minus 1 factor, underlining that one in red. And we look at the power here, so no power is written. That means the multiplicity is 1. Okay, now let's take a look at the other factor, x plus 1. And again, no power written. So the multiplicity is, again, 1. Now, thinking about our patterns, this means that this function will be crossing at each of those zeros. Okay, we're gonna hold that in mind. Now with both pieces of this puzzle, we'll be able to get a sketch to this polynomial. And we're starting basic. We're sketching something that we've already seen how to draw in multiple different ways. So you probably have a picture in mind, but let's kind of forget about that for a second. Pretend that we've never seen it before. So we found our end behavior was for this function. Remember the leading term was x squared. Okay, so with that leading term, we can use it to determine our end behavior without actually having a picture. So if x squared is our leading term, as x goes to negative infinity, let's try plugging in a negative large number. Let's do like negative 1,000. Where is that headed? It's a very large positive number. So that means that our y values are taking off to positive infinity. Okay. So our left end behavior is negative infinity. I'm going to draw a little arrow there. Positive infinity. Draw a little arrow up there. Okay, now let's do the same thing for the right end behavior. As x goes to positive infinity, let's go ahead and plug in a really big positive x value. Okay, when I square a large positive value, I get, again, a very large positive. So again, our end behavior is positive infinity. Okay, so keeping that in mind, our left and right end behavior are set. We have our zeros, we determined what's going to happen at them. So at x equals negative 1 and 1, we're going to have these zeros. We're pretty much going to go ahead and connect our dots. So our arrows are going to tell us where to start and finish our drawing. So working from left to right, I'm going to cross through negative 1. Now crossing means it passes through, and it's okay if it's curvy. Okay, So it's not going to change its curvature at all. Now if I want to keep going with this, I still have to keep going from left to right. I'm going to need to come back and cross through 1. Okay, again, it's a cross, so there's no change in curvature. Okay, there, that's a rough sketch of this polynomial. Now, a side note, let's do a little sticky for it. Okay, and the side note that I want to highlight is we won't know much about maxes and mins in general. Okay, we're going to learn about that kind of stuff in Calc 1. So stay tuned for that. Pretty much, you're going to get some awesome, cool results in calculus that are going to help you figure out, like for instance, in this picture, we kind of just turned it in an arbitrary place around here. But it's like, okay, well, where is that actual point? You know, what is it actually? That's the kind of thing we're going to find out in Calc 1. Okay, so again, I know this was a very, very easy polynomial to sketch. So let's go ahead and jump into how we would sketch a slightly harder polynomial. Let's check out another example. Okay, so this beast, let's take a look at it. Y equals negative 2x times x minus 1 squared times x squared plus 2 times x plus 1 cubed. Okay, so we're going to take a look at this and decide if it is factored or unfactored. So right away, what jumps out at me is that it looks like I have a product, so I'm going to say factored. The thing that would usually throw a student is they'd look at this factor and say like, that's not factored. Okay, but remember, we're looking for factorization over R. Okay, and you might remember from the factoring unit that we've covered that you can factor things additionally if you allow complex zeros. But the thing with graphs is you're never going to be graphing any sort of complex numbers on your real XY axes. So when we factor these, the complex zeros aren't contributing anything to the picture. So we don't need to have the factorization. So this is factored over R. Okay, so let's jump in and do the easier thing first. I think the easier thing when you have it factored such as this is to find your zeros and multiplicities. So let's go ahead and do a little chart with our zeros, the multiplicities, and let's do a little, does it wiggle, does it cross, does it bounce? Okay, so the zeros, I'm gonna underline every single factor. So we've got a negative 2x, we've got x minus 1 squared, we've got x squared plus 2, we've got x plus 1. Okay, so my zeros, and I should emphasize something, we're looking for real number zeros. We're looking for the real ones. So our first factor, negative 2x, is going to have the factor 0. So when I set that equal to 0 and solve, I'll get 0. And what is its multiplicity? I'm going to take a look at the power on the x. It appears the multiplicity is 1. So between wiggle, cross, and bounce, that's going to be a cross. Okay, now let's go ahead and do the same process for the x minus 1. When I set x minus 1 equal to 0 and solve it, I get 1. And what's the multiplicity on that? It appears to be 2. So that means that this polynomial is going to bounce because 2 is an even number. And then check out x squared plus 2. Ooh, when I try and set this equal to 0, when I try to set this equal to 0 and solve, I end up getting plus or minus root 2i. These are not real. Okay, so those zeros are not going to be kept track of. They're not going to show up on the graph, so I won't include it with my chart. Okay, and lastly, we've got the x plus 1 factor. So our last 0 would be negative 1. And then what's its multiplicity is 3. And is it going to wiggle, cross, or bounce? Well, it is 3, an odd number, so that would be a wiggle. Okay, so now keep in mind what is what here. Lots of numbers. The zeros, these are x-intercepts. Okay, and what we did is we figured out what's going to happen at them. Okay, so let's go ahead and check it out. The last piece of the puzzle, we've got our zeros. We need our ending behavior. So the ending behavior on this one's going to be a little more interesting because we need the leading term. Okay, so for the unfactored form, I want to show you guys the fastest way possible to get the leading term. There's a slow way, and there's a fast way to go about this. So the fastest way to do this is to realize that the leading term will be the product of leading terms of the factors. So if you imagined foiling all of this out, expanding all of this out, the biggest power on the x is going to be coming when you product the biggest powers. So let me highlight, let me highlight that in like neon green. Okay, so let's highlight the leading terms of each factor. The first leading term of this factor is negative 2x. Okay, the next one is x, next one is x squared. You see I'm choosing the portion of each factor with the biggest power on x. And notice that the first factor, I include the negative 2 in there, because when you think about it, that will also become part of the expansion. The negative 2 also gets multiplied as well. So our leading term is going to be the product of all of those. Negative 2x times, now pay attention, when we expand this out, our x in the orange factor is squared because that multiplicity was 2. Aha, see, we got tricks over here. And then the next factor is also got an x squared. And then our final factor has x, but it is cubed. So our leading term will be the product of all of those leading terms, and it'll be, remember, the powers add. So it's going to be negative 2 out front, 1 plus 2 plus 2 is 5 plus 3 is 8. Just checking myself, 5 and 2, 7, 8, yep. Okay, so our leading term is negative 2, x to the 8. And now we can figure out our ending behavior. So our end behavior on the left, as x goes to negative infinity, let's check what happens when I plug in a large negative number. Okay, again, we kind of don't have to calculate this on an exact calculator, because I can tell what's going to happen is we have an even power. Raising a negative to an even power is going to keep this positive. So we have a negative times a positive, which is a negative. So that means that this is headed towards negative infinity. Okay, and then on the right, as x goes to positive infinity, let's check if I plug in a really big positive. Okay, that's going to be a negative times a positive, so again, a negative. And that would mean that y is again headed towards negative infinity. Cool. Okay, so now we have all the pieces of our puzzle and we're ready to get a sketch. So let's come down, get our xy axis going. There's our x, there's our y. And let's actually plot our end behaviors. So both were going down to negative infinity. So I'm gonna do the little arrows down here to remind myself where I'm starting and ending my sketch. And then I add in my zeros. So my zeros are negative 1, 0, and 1. Okay. So now I'm going to start tracing from left to right, and I'm going to pay attention. Am I going to cross, wiggle, or bounce as I pass through? So starting my trace here, going up to negative 1. Okay, and at negative 1, I'm supposed to, let's see, at negative 1, I'm supposed to wiggle. Okay, so here's what a wiggle looks like. You come up, you come up, you come up, and then it switches curvature at the 0. So there's my wiggle. Okay, now I'm going to have to turn back down and hit 0. At 0, I'm supposed to cross. So the curvature stays the same. It doesn't have to be a straight line. It's going to have kind of a curve to it, but notice that it's different than a wiggle. It does not look the same as the wiggle, right? Curvature didn't change. Now we're going to have to come back up to get to 1, and it's going to be a bounce. So it bounces off. There we go. Okay, and we end at negative infinity. Now notice that all by itself, on its own, it ended up that we're matching up with our arrow and we're headed down. If for some reason that doesn't match, what it means is you probably made a little mistake either in calculating your end behavior and calculating your zeros, but it should match up so that when you're done tracing, your pencil should have ended where it was supposed to all along. Awesome. So hopefully you guys learned a little something about graphing polynomials today, and I will see you next time.